This small part may look simple enough, but can you identify the four key areas that were a special challenge for manufacturing? This is a part we recently machined for our client. Actually, there were six versions of this, left and right hand, and in three different sizes, but they all share the same geometry. When our client first approached us about making these parts, they sent 3D CAD files and 2D design drawings, such as this one. Since we always start every project with a careful design review of the specifications, let's begin our case study there. We use 2D drawings to understand the GD&T information, that is, geometric dimensioning and tolerancing, or the system of numbers and symbols that specify all the features of a part. Manufacturers need this information not only to program their CNC equipment, but also to measure the parts correctly and to control quality. GD&T is also used to show design intent. This is a very important concept since it helps define the larger environment in which the part is meant to function. Understanding intent helps to resolve design conflicts, as we'll see in this case study. The original drawings listed seven critical to quality dimensions, or CTQs. Frankly, that's a lot for any part, and on this project, it represented a special challenge. In most cases, even for very complex parts, three critical dimensions are usually enough. One of the best practices when using standard GD&T terminology is to ensure that every CTQ is referenced to a datum, and that this datum is clearly indicated on the drawing. This hole location, for example, was marked as critical, but it didn't have a reference datum. Without it, it's impossible to accurately make and measure such a feature. We discovered the importance of this location when the customer shared their assembly drawings with us. We wanted to see how this part was going to fit with other parts and what it was meant to do. It turns out, as we guessed, that this is a pivot point. With this new information, we could then nominate a proper datum for it. As a consequence, it became apparent that some of the other features that rotate around this point didn't really need to be so tight after all. This made them easier to machine while allowing the part to still work perfectly fine. The next important feature we want to point out are these very small grooves or ridges that you can see in this cutout slot. As it happens, these are also critical to function, but we didn't know that. We also uncovered some subtle differences between how Star Rapid and our client were measuring these features. There are a couple of ways to do it, and they each yield different results. The first way, used by our client, was with radii, which you can see in more detail here. In this technique, we first nominated a reference line against which we measured the feature. We used the top edge of the slot to form the reference line, and then created a second parallel line. Next, we identified the peaks and valleys of each groove and measured those as radii to a hypothetical straight line that connected all the peaks. One problem with this method is that the peaks of each groove don't actually fall along a straight line. Rather, they form a spline or a series of line segments connected together to make a jagged edge more like this. That means there really isn't an accurate parallel reference line to measure them against. More importantly, even if the point-by-point measurement formed a straight line, the radial measurement method doesn't give us any information about the shape of the profile in between the points. For example, are the peaks and valleys connected by straight lines, or is the shape convex, concave, or something else? We discovered, and again, this is an example of the importance of understanding design intent, that an indexing pin was meant to ride along these grooves, so the bracket can click to different positions as it's rotated. To form these shapes accurately, it therefore made more sense to use a circular profile as the basis of manufacturing and measurement. The profiles helped us to define the shape of the curve as well as the high and low points. And since we now understood how the part was supposed to function, we could then determine where the center points of the profiles should be referenced against. Since the bracket is going to pivot at this hole, as long as the grooves maintain their tolerance to this point, the part will work correctly. Based on these examples, you can see why we place such an emphasis on understanding the customer's design intent. Once we know what the part is meant to do and how it functions, then we can offer useful input about how to achieve a design that accomplishes this task in the most efficient way. Efficient in terms of performance as well as ease of manufacture. Now, let's consider how the type of material also affected production. The raw material specified here is 17-4PH, a well-known variety of stainless steel. Normally, we can machine 17-4 just fine, if it hasn't already been heat-treated. But our client did want us to heat-treat the 17-4, and heat treatment changes physical properties a lot. Now, why can't we simply machine these parts and then heat-treat them afterwards? Because heat treatment induces thermal stress in the metal, and that will make a finished part warp and distort after machining. Instead, we had to heat treat them before machining. That's the reason for these rough blanks that you see here. We cut out the general profile shapes, heat treated them, let them rest, then put the blanks into custom fixtures like this. As you can see, each fixture holds 8 parts at a time, and we can fit 3 of these tools onto the machine's work table to increase efficiency. That's 24 parts per machine in one setup. The final challenge, and this is also not visible to the naked eye, is that heat treatment increases the material's hardness. We had to use very sharp cutters, operating at just the right speeds and feeds in order to make a nice surface finish with tight tolerances. To sum up, what lessons can you learn from this project that will help you in your product development journey? Number 1, always specify the datums for critical dimensions. Number 2, limit the critical dimensions to as few as possible. Number 3, understand and explain the design intent from the beginning. And number 4, use the measurement method that is best suited for the application. We hope you found this useful, and if so, please like, ding the bell, and consider subscribing to get more great content. We'll see you next time.